want to sign a plan, the Mylar plan for this?
I don't think that that's required.
Pardon?
It's not required for a site plan.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next order of business this evening, under new business, high school playground relocation request by the Cape Elizabeth School Department for relocation of a playground, site plan completeness, section 19-2-9. Ask that the applicant or representative of the applicant come to the podium, identify yourself, and give us a brief summary. Good evening.
I'm Dee LaBelle, the business manager of the school department, and with me is Sue Weatherby, the director of community services and adult education. Do we have a second, please?
Sure.
I didn't get his name, did you?
Mr. LaBelle? Dee LaBelle.
Presently at the high school, a site that we are using for a playground is located by the pool entrance to the rear of the building, by the next to the cafeteria and to the Cape High pool. The structure that is there now is kind of obsolete. It's basically a set of monkey bars, a slide, a swing, and we are proposing to take the location and move it to the other side of the IA wing, where it would be easily accessible to the children's center that we run in the daytime in the morning. And also, Sue has been this year running a daycare or child care during the day and after school for the kids in the front of the building. So what the kids would do is they could come out of the existing building, walk down to the proposed site, and use the facilities. We plan, this is all small, like household type of a playground. It's not like you would see at the middle school presently or at the Farm Cove Elementary School. We plan to put one slide, two swing sets, build one sandbox, and have one other apparatus that we are not to date with. The equipment would all be just placed on the ground. There would be no digging or bulldozing or any backhoe work that's proposed. Therefore, we would not be disturbing the grass or any of the water. There is a catch basin in this area that takes the water from the existing field and just brings it to the back. We did check today because there is some concern that there could be some underground utilities there. In that location, there are none. The only underground utility that comes in that area or close to that area is coming from the middle school, and that's the utilities. It runs right in the middle of the tennis courts alongside of this building and into the transformer over here.
Excuse me, could you slide that a little bit closer? I really can't see the plan. I'm familiar with the building, but still barely coming into focus. There we go.
The proposed location would be, you know, a lot easier or better for access for the kids, and quite a bit safer for all concerned compared to where it is now. The existing structure is quite heavily trafficked as far as the pool area. There's a lot of parking, a lot of deliveries around the kitchen area and the cafeteria section. This new proposed location would eliminate or a lot of those concerns.
Just on the plan, so other board members can identify where the front entrance to the high school is where?
Front entrance to the high school is up over here.
Okay. Where did you say that were they underground utilities?
The underground utilities are from the, up by the portable of the middle school,
mm-hmm.
right through the tennis courts up here, and then back into this area. There's a transformer right here on the ground. So there's nothing. There's no underground utilities here at all.
Okay. Any more to your presentation?
That's all I got. Maybe Sue would want to add a few things, as far as the programs and the accessibility.
Right now, as Dee said, the transformer that is located behind the school is very close to the existing playground. In fact, the reason that the Children's Center would like to move the playground over here is within the next couple of years, they may have to become licensed. And this area would not meet the licensing requirement. And this area over here, because there's a great deal of space, certainly would do that. It also would provide the extended school care program the opportunity to have access to that playground as well.
Could you just give us some idea of in one of the drawings, it shows a limited access gravel roadway, what the use of that roadway is for. It runs right through the middle of the playground area.
Okay. We would not interfere with that roadway as it exists. Right now, it is used occasionally for deliveries to the central supply area of the high school. So once or twice a year, a truck may come in that road and drop things off at an existing door there right by the central supply headquarters.
Do they come during the school year or during the...
Usually in the summertime.
Do you have daycare activity during that time?
Not there, no.
Other questions from board members?
I have some. How many students are you anticipated that will use a playground?
The Children's Center would probably have 15 to 20 during the hours that they would utilize it, and that would be between 9 and 11:30 in the morning. We would utilize it for our kindergarten children that are enrolled in the Community Services Extended School Care Program during the school day. And we have anywhere from 15 to 20 in the morning session and then another 15 to 20 in the afternoon session. After school, we have school-age children, probably 75 children totally in the program, and they would have access to that after the school hours.
Are you proposing any enclosure around the playground?
At this time, no.
There's an existing, I guess, arboretum that was started a few years ago. Is that anywhere near the playground, or is that further up on the beyond the gravel drive?
I don't know that.
This is just a completeness issue tonight.
That's the board's decision. You can act on completeness tonight and choose to hold a public hearing, which would be held at the next regular meeting of the board. A public hearing is not required, however, under this site plan review. So the board could move on to consider the review of the project at tonight's meeting as well.
Okay. Just two other comments then. The gravel walk that goes through the playground, there's some loading activities that are come in over that, service activities, vehicular traffic?
Occasionally.
I think that's the same gravel drive that I mentioned?
Yes.
That seems like in the summer where we receive one delivery of paper, it might be one van that backs up there. Occasionally, if any use at all, it would be probably July and August.
Okay. And I notice from this grading plan that it's sitting right in the middle of a drainage swale. Is there any reason you haven't proposed to move it further away from the building?
Probably because of the slope, that the further you get away from the building, the greater the slope or the area is. We're talking probably a 50 by 80 section, which is, it's a huge area.
Mm-hmm.
And when we staked out 50 by 80, it's like a very small piece of box.
If they moved it up there, they'd take away the sliding area. It's a great sliding hill. Both of my kids have been. I will say that the plan or the submission was not real clear, and I understand because I've dropped my kids off there. I'm not sure that it was in detail or clear enough so that the other board members not familiar with the building would necessarily know where or what you were proposing. I see some nods that... Yeah, I was reading it, and I know the property. I had a hard time from this picture trying to figure out where you might have. I had to ask Maureen where you're planning to to put it. Is there any signage, I'm sorry, is there any signage for where the children are now dropped off previously, and it's been a year since I've dropped my kids there. It was at the back of the building, which was not necessarily the greatest place, off by the soccer field end. A concern is this: the long road, excuse me, down the hill, if you, children are kind of arriving in cars and they see their friends at the play area, that parents don't stop there and say, okay, you run down the hill, and because there is heavy traffic, we're going to limit the upper parking lot in the future, and because part of that will be employee parking for the municipal garage, so I take it that we'll move more parking down there. What type of provision do you have to prevent that type of letting the kids out up on the hill?
Well, parents have to come in and sign out their children now, so that they can't just stop and pick up their child. They actually have to enter the building and sign them out on a schedule, as well as pick up their books and supplies. So I don't think that would be an issue.
Mm-hmm. Dropping them off in the morning?
They aren't dropped off down back in the morning.
Oh, they,
everyone is
the left
dropped off
up front?
Dropped off up front.
Okay. Any questions?
The only other question I have is excuse me.
Sure.
You said that you don't anticipate putting pea stone or any type of surface underneath. The equipment goes right on the turf.
Okay. Other questions? Was it clear enough so other board members can understand the application? Do I hear any motion?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Mr. Emery.
Shall I make one motion and then go for a second one, or shall I propose two motions simultaneously?
Depends on how many voices you have.
I would say one at a time. Okay. Motion for completeness. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted, the site plan review application by the Cape Elizabeth School Department for the relocation of the high school playground from the pool area to the lawn area adjacent to the cafeteria wing is deemed complete in accordance with section 19-2-9 of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented.
Second.
It has been moved and seconded. Is there further discussion? Seeing none, we'll take a vote. All those in favor of the motion as read, raise your right hand. Opposed? It's a unanimous vote. In favor? Do I hear another motion?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Emery.
B, motion for approval with conditions, findings of fact. The applicant wishes to relocate a playground from the pool area of the high school to the lawn area adjacent to the cafeteria wing. This development requires site plan review under section 19-2-9. The application was certified as complete by the May 21st, 1991 meeting of the planning board. The presence of underground utilities underneath the area where the playground equipment will be installed. I'm sorry, that one doesn't apply. And four, the applicant has substantially addressed the standards of site plan regulations. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted, the request of the Cape Elizabeth School Department for site plan approval of the relocation of the high school playground from the pool area to the lawn side of the cafeteria wing be granted, according to section 19-2-9, and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions. And those conditions no longer apply.
So it just ended at facts presented.
That's right.
Second.
It has been moved and seconded. Is there further discussion? Judy?
I just have a question for Maureen. In the proposed condition that we did have, you were asking for the submission of definitive information to the town planner and town engineer with respect to underground utilities. Are you satisfied with the information that you have received?
Yes, I am.
Thank you.
I guess, Judy, that echoes my concern as well. At least some notation be made. Is Ms. LaBelle?
Yeah, just for clarification, it's the industrial arts wing, not the cafeteria.
Uh-huh.
interior sits in.
It's the same.
Cafeteria sits in this location. This is the industrial arts one. Where the shops.
Any further discussion? This has been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, unanimous vote. Thank you very much. Second order of business under new business, and we're about 10 minutes behind schedule, is a public access waiver request by the trustee of the Sleeper Estate property for public access waiver of a lot off Ocean House Road, section 19-4-2B. That's that the applicant or representative of the applicant approach the podium, identify yourself, and give a brief description of your application.
Good evening. My name is Dick Michael. I'm with the firm of Dufresne Henry. It's an engineering consulting firm in South Portland. I'm here representing the owner, who by a minor clarification is actually the estate of Mary Sleeper. The trustee for that estate is the Maine National Bank. With me tonight, I have the attorney for the trustee, Robert Middle, and also an associate of mine, Kevin Fuca, who did some of the legwork in preparing the request tonight. We're here tonight to request a waiver for public access, as stated in your findings of fact there. And so, does anyone see this in the glare on that screen? Just as a way of describing where we are here, this property is an oceanfront property. Closest public access currently is Old Ocean House Road. There is a deeded access. It's the property in yellow on this plan here. There is a deeded access to this property, which as we read the deed, runs something to the effect, as it was originally stated, directly through this road here, which is an improved gravel road in most cases throughout its length. Present access to this area, there is a house on this lot, 9D. There is also a house on lot C. Present access to these two lots is in their deeds as well, two accesses. One, this access, and a second one on a paved road, entirely paved, along this access. We're before the board tonight to request a waiver for public access. The first finding of fact indicates that the owner of the Sleeper Estate is interested in or is applying for a building permit. That's not exactly correct. The intent tonight is to ask whether and assure that this lot is in fact a buildable lot by, because it's not on a public access, by asking for the public waiver. That's all I have for presentation. There was a one other thing. There was a request that the clarification be made for the determination, how the determination for site distance, traffic site distance, was made here. That was by your town engineer, and we supplied that to Maureen earlier this week. You may have copies of that in your file tonight. I don't know for sure. I also had the privilege of reading some of the comments that you have received from abutters. Just as a general comment, it appears as if some of them are confused on what a public access waiver is. Be happy to answer any questions you have.
I think just in way of explanation, some of the comments in the correspondence, I talked earlier with Maureen, and there was a mistake in sending out some of the notifications, an innocent mistake, that it was misread as to lots so and so through that, and only two lots that were notified and so forth, so there was a problem there. There was significant response from the abutters. I guess I'll turn it over to the rest of the board to ask questions, raise concerns.
I would just like to have it started, if we could, by having the town planner indicating for the public exactly what a public access waiver is for. I think the indication is that it means there's public access, and I know that's not the intent.
A public access waiver is when it does not imply that there it will be allowed public travel on the road that's being requested. A public access waiver is a term that's used when a lot does not have adequate frontage on an accepted town road. You must have frontage in order to receive a building permit unless you get a waiver of that requirement. It's called a public access waiver, and what it does is if an applicant can show that there's appropriate access to their lot, then they still may be able to show the board that access is adequate for emergency vehicles and to that lot, and may be able to get a permit for construction even though they don't have frontage on an accepted town road.
Some of the issues, of course, are how many lots does this road serve? It appears very noticeably that it serves more than three lots. The proposed right-of-way is very narrow at spots. There is an issue of the improvement of the existing driveway as it intersects with Old Ocean House Road, and the improvement to that area being acceptable. There's also the issue of the buildable status of this lot. As it is a shore front property and will come under new shoreland zoning in the near future. And I'm sure that's the applicant's interest. Questions, Judy?
I'll ask a couple other questions if I can. Maureen, if there is no building proposed at this time, is there anything in the ordinance that prohibits the acquisition of a public access waiver just to try to ensure buildability from that standpoint?
Typically, an applicant for a public access waiver will show us the building envelope and not necessarily the actual footprint of the building. But it is something that is generated by the request for a building permit. So that has to follow it. The ordinance is silent on the duration of a public access waiver, and I'm assuming that you could place a condition on the waiver if you were concerned that it was going to be granted in perpetuity. Building permits themselves are good for only a certain period of time. Public access waivers don't have an expiration date.
I guess a key issue that one of the many key issues that I see is the emergency access turnaround at the end of the right-of-way does appear to end at this site, and while one of the plans, it's not numbered, but states that proposed lot access driveway to include 20-foot radii for emergency vehicle access, but I don't see in the more detailed plan any area for that. I think that's essential as part of the plan.
One of the problems with that is that the description of the right-of-way for this lot is an old-style description that talks about roughly approximately this place and to the closest end of the lot or nearest with the rights to change in the future if everyone agrees to it. Those, that kind of language. At the present time, the road comes down and enters this lot 9D right here, right straight on and right through a driveway right into lot 9D. There is plenty of room in this area for not for a circular drive to turn around as it would in a cul-de-sac. This is not that kind of location, but there is enough space in that area for a turnaround to be made.
So that a T-head or hammerhead turnaround?
Right, and that certainly could be a requirement, I would think, of anything you say or do. That there be provisions for emergency vehicles to turn around. I might add there, although this access must serve more than one lot, with the exception of lot 9A, the other lots that are here in this area have deeded rights to use this access, which I would say, I'm not sure which one of these houses uses which access, but it is a little bit more of an improved road. In fact, it's a paved road the entire length. And I would guess that most of these folks down here use this road, although I'm not absolutely sure that this road here is certainly adequate. And it is not a
dirt road with grass growing up the center of it. I mean, it is an improved gravel road. And some of these folks may in fact choose to use that road, I'm not sure. But these other lots do have actually two access written into their deeds, whereas this older lot, 9A, is not. But I think there is certainly enough room there to allow a turnaround to be made, especially since this road comes right straight into lot 9A. I would imagine that the road coming into lot A is the top of the Y intersection will take your base.
The town engineer also points out, as I'm sure you've read, that the turn at the intersection of the paved road and the gravel road, need to see some type of improvement or description of how an emergency vehicle might negotiate that turn.
Here or here?
Lot 9C.
Yeah,
right there, yes.
Yeah, that's right. There again, the original access was a straight shot. Yeah.
Mm.
If you were to go out there today, you would find that you could still see what that access was, but it happens to fall right between someone's swimming pool and their house. And it certainly isn't a place where the access should be anymore. This intersection, because it really altered the original location of that right-of-way, it's capable of being improved so the radius was such a vehicle. I had no trouble getting around there in full-size car at all without even approaching getting off the road. But emergency vehicles with longer wheelbase, that intersection should probably have some minor improvements. Okay? Or, as an alternative, I might add, there is the other access. I don't know how
the regulations read for emergency vehicle access. If there is a way to get to a spot through something other than what's the deeded access, whether emergency vehicles have that right to passage or not for safe life and limb and so forth.
This access, I would say, we had no trouble making access fire vehicles
down that way. There are no sharp turns in that
access. Is the applicant proposing only to pave a width of 14 feet for the first 50 feet? Is that correct? At the intersection of Old
yes.
Ocean House?
Yes. That's a fairly typical private drive.
But difficult for two cars to pass each other?
Difficult,
yes, but it's kind of a
drive that has established bounds to it, and widening it even 2, 3, 4 feet might require taking down some pretty large trees and nothing I don't think any of the neighbors would appreciate or really lend itself very well to the atmosphere of that location.
Questions of other board members? I'm sorry.
Two questions.
Ms. Demmer?
How are lot 12B and 12C accessed?
I do not know. Kevin, do you know?
I'm fairly certain that there's no way to get to this road.
I do know that, I'll guess at this, that within about 50 feet or so, there is another driveway cut. So I'm assuming that that would be the entrance with the road back, but I did not go back that far.
So that leaves 12B landlocked. Leaves 12B landlocked?
Well, we don't know that. We don't know if there is this other access or driveway that it doesn't access.
Now, the status of lot 9A, is that a grandfathered lot? Is this not a 2-acre RA?
It is a grandfathered lot. It's under the non-conforming lot provisions. So it was established in 1967, and it's exempt from the standards that go in under 1968. The building inspector has gone over the lot, and it appears to meet all of the standards for buildability, except for the public access.
Okay. That's all.
Other questions?
Just a technicality, I see in our memo that typically the board does hold a public hearing for public access waivers, even though it's not required. Does the board also typically do site walks on requests of this nature?
I think that is up to the board. As the chairperson, I would recommend perhaps in this case that we do. It is not a necessity for a public hearing, is that correct?
Correct.
There is significant public and abutter interest, and I think it has been our due process before to have public hearings. Actually, whether we've had the communication or not.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I feel quite strongly that, particularly because of the snafu about the notice, that even if we were close to the edge on this one, that I would certainly recommend a public hearing just for relations with the neighborhood as much as anything else.
Other discussion? Do I have a motion?
I would like to make a motion. Propose the following motion for tabling. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted, the request of the estate of Mary Sleeper for a public access waiver for a lot, map R2, lot 9A, located off of Old Ocean House Road, is tabled to the regular June meeting of the Planning Board in accordance with section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance. A public hearing is scheduled for the regular June meeting. A site walk of the property shall be scheduled. Can modify that.
It has been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and second. Is further discussion? So the motion is to table until our next meeting, at which time we will schedule a public hearing. And previous to the June meeting, we will schedule a site walk. Any further discussion?
I assume the applicant would be willing to entertain us with respect to a sidewalk.
What a place to entertain you, I'll tell you. You're going to pick a day like today. Certainly. I don't know how you schedule those, whether you would like to decide or pick a tentative time tonight or...
Right. What I'd like to do is take a vote, and then we'll schedule it right after the vote.
Mr. Chairman, did you say it would be continued to determine a date for a public hearing at the June meeting?
No, that we would schedule a public hearing for the June meeting.
Okay.
Any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? Unanimous vote. What days of the week are best for the board members? Saturday mornings, evenings? We have plenty of evening time now.
Weekday evenings
is best for myself as well. Quite in July. Tuesday, 3 weeks from today, will be...
Is that the 11th?
Wow, you're fast.
You have a planning board orientation scheduled for June 11th.
I knew that.
I was trying to put it on. Sorry.
What time is the orientation?
We do it just prior to...
7 o'clock.
7 o'clock? Could we make it to the site, say, at 6:15, 6:30? Is that...
I got to give you some time?
Yes. Yes. How about if we set it for 6:30?
For a 7 o'clock meeting thereafter?
Yes.
Doesn't sound like enough time to walk in there and walk out.
6:15.
Can we drive in?
Our meeting is only scheduled for 1 hour. The orientation on the, I think it's a zoning ordinance. If we encroach on that a little bit.
Sure.
What's the wishes of the board? 6:15. On the evening of June 11th, is that okay with the applicant?
Yes.
I was
house. Is it the...
At the gravel access road.
Right.
It's a restored white colonial. There are two entrances marked Webster Farm. It's on the south end.
So is it also the one you have like Garrison Field and Webster Farm on either side? Is that...
Yes. The upper entrance is Garrison Field and the southern one is Webster.
Okay.
June 11th.
Okay. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Our last item of business, the new business, is... And now I'm trying to find Mr. Jones's letter. I would ask, our last item of business is in reference to Jonesy Service Center, requesting an extension time to complete the site improvements at the Jonesy Service Center. Applicant, could identify yourself and give us a brief
explanation. My name is Greg Jones, and I'm manager of Jonesy Service Center. Appreciate the board agreeing to consider this issue tonight. As an oversight on my part, I let my expiration date come and go for completion of all my renovations. When the deadline was set back in June, I had no idea 11 months wouldn't be adequate to complete everything. It was my fault in not flagging my calendar to tell me to come in a certain time and properly request an extension. And so the site plan approval is actually expire. We're requesting that it be amended to section, excuse me, amend section G to read improvement should be completed by May 18th of 92 to give us the upcoming year to put the finishing touches on the project. Substantially, the project is complete, the canopy and the underground tanks, the building remodeling is done. We found some contamination behind the building where a waste oil tank was situated and has since been removed. And as a result of that, I had to deal extensively with the DEP and make application for some financial assistance from the state under the groundwater cleanup fund. That took several months and has since been granted. But the work itself is just scheduled to begin soon. I don't have an exact idea of how long it will take. I certainly expect the contamination could be cleaned up in the next 2 or 3 months. But having dealt with the DEP, I know that certain hurdles have to be jumped, and sometimes they extend your expected time frame. When the contamination is cleaned up, the last order of business of paving, striping, curbing, and new grass and flowers to be installed, they would be completed. The cleanup of the contamination is what's holding up these minor end details, and that's why I'm here tonight to ask for an extension to give us enough time to complete those minor details without the site plan actually being voided and having to go through the whole process again, since it was quite involved the first time. So
I guess my initial question would be, although you don't know the time frame, what's the extent of the remediation required for the contamination?
Well, I consider it minor, but of course that's judgmental. It's an area of about 20 feet by 20 feet. We've got to dig down about 10, 15 feet, I'm not sure. At this point in time, we'll be under the direction of the DEP to perform the remediation as they see fit to their satisfaction.
Have they given you any guidelines? Is it a case of aerating the soil?
That's
actually incinerating the soil?
That's just beginning now. Probably what will happen is a large section of the dirt will be taken out and trucked to Norwich where it's incinerated in some fashion.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I expect to happen. That process is just now beginning. I'm trying to get the ball rolling on it, and even that's taken me a little time. This groundwater cleanup fund is new. I was one of the first few applicants, and as a result, the people in Augusta are kind of muddling through it, and you can't get a straight answer by asking the right people. They have to research it and get back to you in several days, and that's what delayed this whole process. But I would expect 2 to 3 months' time would be adequate.
And after the remediation, the reason you can't surface the site, parking area and the final coat of survey is because of the remediated hauling and
the paving company doesn't wish to do it piecemeal. They want to come in when we're all done and do it all up. They've been arranged. The quote is in hand, and they're ready to do it as soon as the remediation is done. But we don't know exactly when.
The questions from the board. What are the wishes of the board?
I move that we grant the applicant a 6-month extension until the regular meeting of the planning board in November 1991 to comply with the requirements of our site plan approval.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been seconded. Discussion. Maureen?
In talking with our town attorney, he's recommending that we consider this an amendment to the previous approval rather than an extension.
Could you explain what?
Well, it's kind of hard to extend something that's already expired.
Okay.
Whereas you could amend Condition G and revised the date that all the improvements to the site have to be completed.
I withdraw my earlier motion. And right in the present discussion, I move that the previous site plan approval condition G be amended to delete the date May 18, 1991, and substitute in lieu thereof the regular meeting of the planning board in November 1991.
It has been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there further discussion? Maureen, just in your discussion with legal counsel, do you think that's an appropriate amendment?
Sounded good to me.
Okay. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's unanimous vote.
Thank you very
certainly.
Much.
It's a six-month, basically a six-month amendment. I would mark your calendar in case it does not proceed and try to come in before
yes,
it expires.
Yes, thank you very much.
Certainly.
There's been entirely too much unanimity on the board.
It has been all unanimous votes this evening. That happens occasionally. Are there any other issues to take up before the board? Look of confusion, Trudy?
I've talked to Maureen a little bit about this. Dr. Rand of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust has indicated that there is a need for a planning board member to sit on the land trust's, is it the board of directors, Maureen? And I wondered at what point that would be brought up before the board.
I would ask that the town planner remind me again to the appropriate. I have that memo, I believe, in the letter form from Mr. Rand, Dr. Rand, and I should have taken care of that, I believe.
Tell us what he wants, a planning board member to sit on this board?
It's part of their bylaws that a planning board member sits on the board of directors of the land trust. Previously, it was Dick Tinsman. He's now resigned from the planning board. So they need a new director. I can put it on the agenda for
yes,
the next meeting.
Please do.
Okay.
Any other issues? Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Seconded?
Second.
All in favor? Thank you. Good evening. After telling all of you to make sure your mic's on.